Hello, and welcome to the fifth and final episode of this miniseries, The Taste of Rumsalt. Right off the top, I would like to say that it has been a pleasure producing this series. The idea for this series started during a conversation between Marie Westner and myself to be part of my residency at the Museum of Anthropology. I was going to document the creative process of composing and producing the Rumsalt Orchestra's next project, which highlights indigenous poetry and storytelling. This podcast evolved into a way to daylight social problems and to give voice to communities that sometimes find it hard to attract the spotlight. With this came a more labor-intensive production cycle, which required longer and more nuanced episodes, and we hope you have enjoyed them. Most importantly, it has been an absolute privilege to produce this podcast on the unceded territories of the Coast Salish peoples, the Squamish, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Musqueam nations. The Museum of Anthropology shares this privilege and acknowledges it is built on the unceded ancestral territory of the Musqueam people. Following this episode will be the first release of the Rumsalt Orchestra, entitled Painting the Sisters. The backstory and inspiration to this release is described in episode 3 of this series, which details a long piece I composed in response to visual works by contemporary Aboriginal women artists from Australia. After this, our group will be working to produce the upcoming release that was the initial basis for this podcast. It involves some of the most exciting Indigenous poets and storytellers in Canada. I'm honored to work with the amazing musicians in this project and am humbled by the poets and storytellers that are contributing to the effort. Today, we will circle back to this work, pairing music and Indigenous storytelling. It is difficult to intimate the importance of storytelling in Indigenous communities across the country. Stories are teacher, friend, elder, parent, knowledge keeper, truth teller, deceiver, spirit. Stories are history of place, history of people, history of knowledge. The tradition is as diverse as the people. Stories are the documents that help bind the diverse people and nations across Canada, and the storytellers keep those documents, transform them, and pass them on. Growing up in Whitehorse, I was fortunate enough to be exposed to many stories of Crow and other beings. I remember an early love for the intensity of these stories. The teller pulled no punches and didn't worry about frightening the children. On the contrary, sometimes getting children accustomed to fear is exactly the point. Stories can hold lessons for the listener as well as the teller. They teach about the natural world and the curious and guiding spirits that are so often just on the other side of the veil. All is to say, there is something profound about Indigenous storytelling traditions and the ways of passing them on to the next generations, involving artistry, a keen knowledge of history and ancestry, humility, personal growth and introspection, and, of course, performance. Perhaps the single most impactful takeaway from producing this series was the opportunity to speak to inspiring women thought leaders. Today, I'm happy to say, we continue this trend. Today, we speak to a master storyteller and keeper of stories for her community. In addition to this, Louise Prophet-Leblanc is a cultural educator, artist, and writer from the Natchonyakden First Nation in Mayo in northern Yukon. She has devoted her life to cultural and artistic preservation. These efforts include being the co-founder of two seminal organizations of the North, the Yukon International Storytelling Festival and the Society of Yukon Artists of Native Ancestry. She also served as coordinator for the Aboriginal Arts Office at the Canada Council for the Arts. Her long and impactful career is difficult to itemize, as these bios usually call for, but I think it's safe to say she has dedicated herself to passing on stories and teachings to following generations. She has recorded innumerable traditional stories, working with the Yukon government as the Yukon Native Heritage Advisor. She has mentored and exposed young people to traditional teachings and has told stories across the country and globe. She always pays tribute to the elders she has had the privilege to work with and protects their stories as much as she can. Perhaps most importantly, Louise was nurtured by the traditional stories told by her grandmother and Aunt Sydney, who were both masterful storytellers. She fell in love with the power of story early in life. I reached Louise over the phone to have a discussion about storytelling, our shared home of Yukon, the story that we chose to collaborate on entitled Snowy Owl, and where the country finds itself, especially regarding Indigenous rights, justice, and the path to reconciliation.
Hey, Alex. Nice to hear you. As you know, my name is Louise Prophet LeBlanc, and my Indigenous name, my Natural Nayakdan First Nation, is where I'm from, and that's the Northern Tishoni language from northeastern Yukon. That's where I'm from. So in our language, you'll say, Indian Doho Te. That means, how's the world treating you? And my name is Tsadana. As a beaver woman. So I'm introducing myself, and I got that name from Elien. That's my grandma. And she's the one that introduced me first to the wonderment of stories, storytelling. This became part of my life, living with her.
Right.
Okay, so where did it all get started? Probably got started before I was born. I probably was exposed to some of these stories, you know, while I was still in utero. But I had really the pleasure of living with my grandmother, you know, sometimes during holiday periods, or sometimes she would just take me home with her. She needed company, so I would live with her for a couple of months. And she always had all of her friends come over, and it was a multilingual get together, because there was people there from the Northwest Territories, from Old Crow, from the Mayo area, from Carmax, all living within this little community of Mayo, which is where the Natcho Nayakdan First Nation people are from. So most of my life I grew up with these wonderful, primarily women, but later on in my life I started to sit around the campfires, you know, with my grandma. I hear men tell stories as well. Auntie Angela, she always said, you know, Louise, you have to live your life like a story. So when you go, she said, people are going to tell a good story about you. And she said, the stories are about our ancestors' lives. It's about our people, she said, how we manage to stay alive here. Hard winters. Sometime no game, all that, she said, it's in the stories. Like this story here, this Snowy Owl story, was told to me by a wonderful man, Stanley Jonathan. And Stanley Jonathan is from the Northern Tishoni people. He's part of the huge language family of the Northern Tishoni people, which is what I am too. It's called Dunk'e. It's not related at all to Tlingit. It's Athabascan language. And, you know, over the years, I discovered, you know, Alex, that you can't run away from story. Like, stories that are for you and are going to help you in the community, they're your story. They don't leave you. You remember them. So It's not like I'm going around, you know, picking this story and picking that story. The stories I'm not supposed to tell, or I'm not don't have the privilege of holding, I call myself a story keeper, you know. I'm keeping these stories. They just go in one ear and out the other if they're not meant for me to share. I feel that so strongly, and I explained that to Auntie Angela one day. She said, that's right. She said, lots of stories my grandma told me. I don't remember them. Just the ones you can tell, she said, that's the ones going to stay with you. That's how she explained it to me. And in these stories, she said, it's not just cute little story. Lots of stuff in there, she said. And every time you tell the story, you understand it a little bit deeper. Everybody that hears a story hears it from their own frame of reference. They hear it with their own mind. They see the images with their own eyes. They hear it with their own ears, and they kind of, assimilate the story to who they are. So a lot of these stories, I have to do the whole front end, like when I begin the story, to place the young people, our children, in a place where they have never been, where their ancestors grew up. So sometimes, I have to paint that picture and all these cultural practices, of the people and how they fished and how, there's one beautiful story about this man, everybody was starving and he's just a young guy and he didn't know what to do, but he just prayed about it and he went down to the lake and it's really dark at night in the Yukon. Of course, it was lit up by moonlight. And he went down to the water hole, he took the tarp off, and he cut a piece of his own flesh, and he put it on the hook, and he put it inside the water, and he caught a fish. He saved the people from starving. And the children are just stunned, to think. I said, and this is how we learn from this story, how you have to sacrifice yourself. I mean, you don't have to cut off a piece of flesh, but you have to sacrifice. You have to make some kind of changes in your own life to serve the rest of the community. Even that story, the Snowy Owl story, that took place a long time ago. But you look at the principles in the story and you say, wow. In fact, some people say, wow, that's what's happening. And I say, yes. And so where does the knowledge sit? It sits with those that have been knowledge keepers, and it comes forward. And the whole business, the separation of young people from elders, this is a very dangerous time.
Our conversation turned to her work with community, the moment Canada finds itself in, and the recent activism surrounding justice and reconciliation.
Yeah. Well, this is a big word, justice. I used to try and figure that out when I worked as a mental health nurse. Justice, what is justice? I would, kind of look around me and I would say, wow, there's a lot of injustice, but what is justice? And I think, heading into my seventh decade here, I'm just now coming up to understanding a little bit of it. But what I do realize is that if you have justice, you have unity. That's the purpose of it. Okay, like if you hurt me, if you've harmed me, and we go to court, and you go to jail, am I helping you? You see what I mean? So that's not justice. The just thing to do, and this was really encompassed in many traditions. If you harm somebody, you have to pay by working for that family, by providing for them. For the family member for whom you've harmed, the whole family has to be taken care of. I'll give you a perfect example, okay? Auntie said, got to make sure all the ice is cleaned off the front of my porch, she said, because, years ago, she said, if people come to your place, maybe your camp, and there's ice, they slip, they hurt their leg. Now, she said, for the rest of their life, you gotta give them meat and you gotta take care of them because you were negligent. She said, you didn't do a good job so that they can have that freedom. So when we talk about justice, You know, I always think about reconciliation. How do you get to reconciliation? This is a thing I'm working on, you know. I made these 7 lamps out of caribou hide. I call them spirit lamps. And I recognize that, you know, they're like valleys. Like you're searching for justice. Some people are so angry they can't see. So in their search, they're blinded by the anger because it is unjust. It was not fair. But you know, these things, the things that have happened to us have also strengthened us. I'm not saying that everybody has to be injured in order to become strong, but we have to say, okay, this happened, now what? So you search for truth. Okay, you search for knowledge. What? Why did this take place? But then what am I going to do with that? So you attain that knowledge. And once you've done that, then you start to realize that, you know, people are all in different conditions of maturity or immaturity, right? Some people are never mature. Like they just don't get it. They don't get it that you should be kind to other people. That you should learn to love people who are not like you. That you should respect people. You know, be honest with the people. So that's when you, all of a sudden, you start to say, wow, if I'm hating this person, then I'm not really loving myself either. So with knowledge, you start to say, you know what? These people were not educated. That's how I've come to understand it. They weren't educated, so I have to educate myself about what made them tick. You know, like a lot of people are saying, oh, the colonizers. Well, you know, we have to admit it. Not all the people that came here wanted to hurt and harm people. It was, like you said, government enforcement. Okay, take the Indian out of the child. That's where it was at. So with that being said, you know, you move into realizing that people have to get along. You know, this whole business of the truth and reconciliation, I thought long and hard about this. It was very difficult for me. I have to find a place where I can forgive, forget, and carry on. That's a hard job. Very hard. And there's a lot of stories about that too. So I'm happy when I can share stories that make reference to this so that I can be content in myself, that I don't have to carry around this baggage. I don't have to carry around anger because I'm, you know what? I think this is why a lot of our people are dying of heart attacks. Young people, 40 years old, 50 years old, my goodness. It's because their heart is still broken and it's been fired by anger. I sincerely believe that. So if I can get to a point of, okay, it's not my luggage, if you will. It's not my baggage, how these people treated us. In fact, these ancestors of these people that we have to live with, we have to work with every day, it's not their baggage either. We have to learn how to get along. So that's where I find a contentment. And, you know, once you do that, it's just this, life becomes wonderful. You say, what am I here for? You know, I have a job to do and I can't let this thing hold me back, this anger or this, you know, you beat me up, come over here, I'm going to beat you up kind of attitude. You know, that's a kind of adolescent behavior, right? So I have these 7 spirit lamps, and the last one I figured it out is, in the end, you can look back and there's absolutely nothing there. You can feel free of that. You know, it's been a big load, but you can be free of it and carry on and work towards building, not deconstructing, but building, constructing a new way.
For this final episode of The Run, we wanted to have some fun and create a pilot of what is to come with the upcoming album by the Rumsalt Orchestra, composing to indigenous poetry and storytelling, creating a soundtrack to support the poet or teller's words, enveloping the oration in a soundscape, and doing our best to elevate the indigenous voice with music. For this episode, we worked with Louise to do just this. After the difficult task of choosing a story from Louise's vast repertoire, I went into the studio with just a few musicians from the Rumsalt Orchestra, a small 5-person contingent of the larger orchestra. After taking some time to myself to compose and arrange some of the sections, we performed a simple, minimalist trial run, you could say, and created a soundscape for Louise's story, Snowy Owl. All of the music you will hear was written and performed over a matter of days and composed exclusively for this story. It was a pleasure having Louise's narration guide our instincts. And now, Snowy Owl.
Hi. I'm Louise Prophet LeBlanc. I'm going to tell you a story about Snowy Owl. Snowy Owl is a character, is a mythical creature, the giant Snowy Owl I'm referring to, of the High North. Apparently, according to my elders who told me this story, Stanley Jonathan from the Northern Toshone told me this story. He said years ago, when pickings were really bad, Snowy Owl was hungry. Because she was a giant, she had a big appetite. And as she was flying around in the winter, she saw this little group of people, a little small little village. They lived in like families, large families, extended families. And she looked down at that and she realized that that was a food source. So she decided what she was going to do. And after everybody was sleeping, she came down very quietly. Now, you might not know it, but when a snowy owl lands, their feathers are such that they don't make a noise. And she crept into these little tents and stole all the babies away. Eat them to appease her hunger. Whoa. Now that caused quite a fear in the community, quite a stir, lot of crying. The mothers felt so guilty. The children also felt that they were responsible for not taking care of their little baby sister or brothers. The older youth wondered what they should do. The mothers, the fathers, everybody. Now in this community, I should tell you, there was only one elder. I don't know why. And this elder was an old, grizzled up old lady. Very wise, very knowledgeable, and sought out by everybody in the community for her knowledge and her wisdom and her love. She comforted everybody. She comforted the mothers. She comforted all those families for the loss of their little babies. It must have been very difficult to not have any more crying in the village. So time passed, and the snowy owl was getting hungry again. This time, she came in for the kill. She came in for the next batch of children, small children, one by one, not all at the same time. Everybody became very fearful again. After she had taken all of those children, they set up a protection of dogs in front of their camps. But Snowy Owl can eat dogs too. And she did. Pretty soon all the little children were snaffled up. Snowy Owl, being wise as well, let some time pass. Next she came in for the youth, the older children, the young adults. One by one, she'd take them when they were fast, fast asleep. And in the morning, the parents would wake up and their young adults were gone. No children, no laughter, and none of this very strong energy of young people was lasted in the community. The old woman intervened. She comforted those parents. She said to the men, "You must start fires all around the village. I've noticed that this taking, these thefts of people's lives, happens at night. Start fires." And the men did that. Of course, they would get tired. Sometimes they would go to sleep at the fire. And unfortunately, that's when the snowy owl would come down and took those men's wives, their loved ones, kill them and eat them. Now you can imagine what kind of grief and sorrow came over those men, so much so that they couldn't think straight. When all of their wives were gone, they had no more children, they had no more babies, no more young ones, no more future. So sorrowful that they would just avoid lighting a fire. They really didn't care about their lives. And that's the condition that Snowy Owl wanted them to be in. And one night as she came down to pluck one of them off, the old lady said, "Ah, I see you there." She said, "I can even eat old ladies when I get really hungry. Hunger will be my boss." And she just gave her the eye. When the last man was taken from that community, and the only standing person there was the old lady, she remained calm. She remained brave. She dug a huge hole. She had this carved out wooden shovel. She dug into the ground. She dug this big hole. And she cut down all of these willows, and she wove this kind of roof on top of those willows. Then she interlaid, wove moss into that frame. And on top of that moss, she started a little fire. She knew that her days were numbered, and she waited. Every day, every night, she waited. And this one night, she had a little fire burning there. Snowy Owl came down quietly. "You look pretty delicious to me," she said. And the old lady said, "Oh, I was wondering when you're going to come for me. But I'm going to be tough," she said. So you better work up a good appetite. Ah, I see you got the snow there on your tail feathers. Why don't you turn around and melt the snow off, she said. Then you get a good appetite. So that's what the snowy owl did. She turned around, she melted the snow off. Oh, come on, turn around this way, she said. Warm your wings, she said. You're going to have to really get ready to eat me because I'm not going to taste so good too, she said. And as Snowy Owl was going like this, enjoying, feeling the heat from that little fire, she closed her eyes for 1 second. And that old lady took that same shovel that she had dug that hole and she pushed that Snowy Owl into that frame. And in that hole, she had carved out these poles, pointed poles. And that Snowy Owl impaled herself and died down there. And the fire fell on top of her and cooked her. The old lady waited for her to cook. And then she made a little ladder and went down into the hole and brought up her meat from the snowy owl. She ate her. And she saved the beak, this beautiful owl beak. She packed a lot of that food. She dried it, put it in her backpack. And she thought, I'm going to go upriver. I know some more of my people live upriver. And she put that great big beak in her backpack. And they say that when she was walking down the river, she sang a beautiful song. And the old man who told me this story, he said, I don't remember the song. But she sang a song. And the song said, this is never going to happen again, because I got Snowy Owl on my back.
I want to thank you for listening to this episode and this series. And as mentioned before, keep your ears keen to releases by the Rumsalt Orchestra. You'll be able to find them on Spotify or anywhere else you stream music. Thank you to Louise LeBlanc for her stories and wisdom. Marie Wessner, the curator of public programming and engagement, produces this podcast. And once again, thank you to the Museum of Anthropology for supporting this podcast. My name is Alex Morrison. Thank you for listening, and you can be assured I have some exciting releases in store, and I hope you enjoy them, as I hope you have enjoyed this podcast. Signing off, and as always, be safe and keep well.